to the number one podcast in the whole entire wrestling community, and I'm one of your hosts, Juanzo.
And I'm your other host, Jean-Paul Leck.
And together we are Robrick. How's every single one of you, family? It is Thursday, so it's time to talk about NXT UK. You know, out of all the shows in the WWE, probably this is more watchable, and also like the one that like presents better storytelling. Match quality, incredibly interesting. But today, Paul has a complaint because the booking was really bad. And, you know, when it comes to like the semifinal of the Heritage Cup, I'm really pissed. Not so much maybe like the triple threat match at the end of the show. Maybe, you know, I give that a pass, but like I'm pissed about the first match. So, Paul, your thoughts on this NXT UK?
Oh, I'm going to echo your thoughts, and I'm sure you'll feel the same way. If, you know, the opening match had a different outcome, you know, the main event match, you know, that would have been okay. I can deal with that. But, you know, both on the same show, you know, I think, I mean, at least for us, I'm sure a lot of people are like, what are you guys talking about? You know, like, I like who won. And people maybe who didn't even see the show are like, well, just tell us who won. And we will. Don't worry. We'll get there.
Yeah, we will.
I think, you know, this episode of NXT UK, I enjoy every week. But, you know, it was between the booking, you know, the winners of some of these matchups. And just with what we saw last night, you know, we're not marks. You know, we're not fanboys. We don't jump the bandwagon. But, you know, if you have the picture, throw it up. AEW Dynamite, you know. Grand Slam, whatever they're called, you know. But that opening match, Brian Danielson, Kenny Omega, you know, that was the match of the week. I don't think anything's gonna beat that. And you know, this, you know, and we have a pay per view this week too. So I don't know how embarrassing is that for WWE, but you know, this was great. This, they've been putting on good shows, you know, the past couple of weeks. So Dynamite, like we said, we gotta acknowledge them when, you know, when it's good. So if you want to hear our thoughts, go check out that full review.
But please do that, yeah. Because you know, we did a lot of you know, like I said, like Brian Danielson and Kenny Omega. I saw a meme that like said, may I get more, sir? You know, like that kid that like wants a little bit more food, and then you see like the picture of Omega and that Brian Danielson, and maybe a lot of people are saying Iron Man match. We'll see, but like, you know, please, like Paul says, you know, go subscribe to the page first, give the video a like, you know, also hit the bell for notifications, and then watch all that great, you know, analysis we call a move my move, everything, you know, all of that we do. So thank you, family. And now let's talk about semifinal of the Heritage Cup. And this was like, whoever comes out of this is going to, you know, go against Noam Dar and, you know, Wolfgang and Tio Man. You know, this, we were rooting for Tio Man big time. We thought that like, okay, easy booking right here. Tio Man is like the guy. He's another heel. Can go against Tyler Bate. Noam Dar can be like, you know, even the match is going to be more enjoyable because it's like similar build, you know, similar physique. But no, Paul, absolutely not. The first wrong, probably one of the worst booking decisions here on NXT UK so far.
Yeah, what's the one thing that almost always happens unless you're an absolute jobber or a loser? We always say, okay, the first round's the feeling out process. These guys, okay, you know, lots of lockups, you know, whatever. And it's like, okay, maybe a big move here or there, but nobody really has that clear-cut advantage. That's usually how these first rounds go. You can almost fast forward through the first round. Not this time. Wolfgang hits that big spinning suplex, you know, and gets a pin. And I'm like, are you kidding me? So that set the stage for pretty much the whole, you know, everything that followed in the second round. You know, Tio Man looked a little bit better, but you know, right as it ended, Wolfgang hit a big uppercut. So still, Wolfgang looks not dominant as the round ends.
And the whole thing dominated by Wolfgang. Like even they said in commentary, right? Like one punch of like Wolfgang is like 10 of Tio Man, something like that. They said.
So I feel it was like, now this isn't a conspiracy. I'm not trying to start like that, but just the way like this match felt, it was like they were low key burying him like throughout this whole thing, because anytime a big move happened, Raja would jump up on the apron, then Gallus would jump up on the apron, and it seemed like the only one who would ever get distracted by this was Tio Man.
I mean,
I get it, because I don't want to say I get it, but like his thing is all my family, blah blah blah, this and that. But eventually, you know, he does hit like a big kick to the head, and he gets the sliding
forearm.
Like the sliding forearm or whatever they called it. He hits that, so he gets a pin. But you know, then pretty much like we see in the final, what was it, the fourth round or fifth round, I believe it was.
Fourth round. Didn't even go to fifth. No.
Not even fifth. You know, I'm like I said, they treat this guy like shit. And you know, again, Raja's on the apron. Tio Man goes to look at him, gets distracted. Wolfgang turns him around. You know, Tio Man jumps out of the way. He does a handspring, but he gets countered by a big spear after he comes off the ropes and lands on his feet. You know, Wolfgang pins him 1-2-3. And I didn't like this because I thought, okay, you know, I mean, he was selling the arm. He tried to get, you know, his cross face in a bunch of times, but Wolfgang fought out of it.
He never got it.
I'm thinking, okay, you know, maybe they'll do something after this where, you know, they attack Gallus from behind and they really beat that arm up. So then he's going into the match, you know, whenever he goes against Devlin, or not Devlin, excuse me, the smaller opponent. So then if he goes in, oh, I only have one arm, it makes it easier for Noam Dar to get the win, who should get the win. Because if Wolfgang wins this and goes against complete shit.
It's like, why you surround this with heels, and then, you know, Wolfgang wins.
Yeah, because no offense. I mean, I liked Wolfgang, you know, when we saw him before he joined Gallus, and I still am a fan of his, but... You know, I don't see people going, push Wolfgang, push.
No.
Nobody's saying this, so I don't know. No. If he would win the whole thing, it would be really bad.
No, this is the final that we have right there left for the Carriages Cup. Noam Dar needs to win. Now, because we were actually rooting for Tio Man, it was going to be like, you know, 50-50 here, easy, because both guys have like the same type of like promo work, the same physique, like I mentioned before, same qualities in both guys. But now that Wolfgang got in the mix and Tio Man is out, please, Noam Dar, get the win, because this should be the Heritage Cup champion. He will legitimize that even better than Tyler Bate, just because Tyler Bate is in the middle with that thing with Trent Seven.
Yeah, and I was just going to touch on that with Trent Seven. I was going to say, especially with the segment that we saw later on, kind of the tag division, maybe they end up booking something that they have this match. You know, let's say Noam Dar, we can talk about it now. It's a little out of order. But it don't affect the show. You know, you see him there, and then you have Trent Seven. He's like, the rock bottom was way better than the bookend. You guys are being bullshit. And they're like, no, we're not bullshit. He's like, you know, oh, well, you're going to be bullshit against us in the ring. And they're like, oh, huh, what's that? He's like, oh, come on. He's like, don't you fancy a match? And they're like, yeah, we fancy it. So I'm like, okay, like, I love, you know, their slang over there. You know, this is good. And, you know, this is going to be, again, a good showing for Ashton Smith and Oliver Carter. They're going to be in there with, you know, one of the top teams here in NXT UK. I would say the top team that's not tag champs, you know, right underneath them, Mustache Mountain. And I would love to see something where they book a match, not another title match, but they book a match, something where it's like they have a tag team match the same night that Tyler Bate has to defend the Heritage Cup, and the tag match is on first, so he's already done, and then he loses it to Noam Dar, and then he blames Trent Seven, why are you booking matches without me being there, blah blah blah, because that's the one thing they said, oh, don't you want to ask Tyler? No, it's fine, you know, we'll have the match.
They're throwing you reasons why this is going to break up. At least they're giving you, like you said, like they're giving you the information right there.
I hope that's done deliberately, and it's not, you know, just, oh, he actually doesn't care, and then, you know, they never break up. Like,
yeah,
I hope
that would be exactly. Like, no, there has to be a point for you to throw those type of, like, narrative right there.
Yeah.
Let's go to, like, also Blake Davenport or Bea Priestley. You call him however you want to, but, like, she just says, hey, you know, I'm not reinstated. The chaos is going to still happening. I'm just going to keep, like, you know, we're just taking care of superstars and all of that. Still, for me, intriguing, but at the same time, very confusing. I don't know where this is going. I don't know if, like, in the end, they're just going to book the match with, like, Meiko Satomura, and that's how it's going to be the end, but still very confusing for me.
Yeah, I mean, I was almost waiting for her to get, like, real fired up, and something where she's just like, you know, oh, you saw what happened. Reinstate me. And then, like, done. I was like, so... It never really went anywhere. I'm like, is she going to have, like, one of the girls tied up in the back, you know, with her there? And she's like, oh, you know, I'm going to start, like, beating these people up. But I mean, this just feels weird. I would have rather just seen her been on the show and her just run through everybody.
No, yeah, that would have been a little better. But, like, you know, I don't, like I said, the suspension for me still doesn't make any sense. I don't know what that is gonna, like,
the only thing I can think is maybe, which I don't know, maybe she's injured, maybe she injured herself, tweaked something, so it's like, okay, this is a way to kind of keep
kind of like not have her in the show, and then yeah, you still have her. Maybe that could be, like you said, an easy way out for that. We'll see. But, you know, we got to see also, like, subculture, you know, these guys, of course, like, they're pretty popular amongst, like, you know, the teenagers and teens, you know, in this NXT UK universe. So, like, you saw that they start feuding with Simon Gradwell, right? I don't know how that's going to turn out, but, like, pretty interesting regardless. Like, he is just talking to them, and then he actually did something to their logo. So, like, so,
yeah,
you
yeah,
know.
You could see, like, I don't want to insult them if they are actually, you know, graffiti artists and can use a can of spray paint. But, you know, you saw that their logo was spray painted there. He wrote Yog on it, like, because he always calls people a yogurt. So, Y-O-G, a Yog. You know, he has that on there. And, you know, I like Sam Gradwell. And, you know, I like subculture. I like Gradwell more. I always side with the heels. Unless it's a really likable, legit baby face, I always side with the heels. But, you know, both these groups are, you know, the one group and this guy, Gradwell, they are in desperate need of a win. So this isn't a feud I would do because it's like, oh man, both of them need a win.
Who do you? Yeah, who do like you made them lose?
But like, you know, I said, I would rather push Gradwell, but I think it's like, who's more marketable? Okay, you have young, attractive guys. You have a young, attractive girl. So okay, any man or woman can like this group, and they have the cool merch, the hoodies, the spray paint, the skateboarding. It's like, who's more marketable? I think them, but who is a better, overall in the wrestling scheme, I would say Gradwell.
Oh yeah, Gradwell is, but like you said, maybe Gradwell is the Dusky's role. You're kind
because
of like
one of my favorite things.
Win every now and then, or maybe every so often, and then just like those two guys and put them over, so like they can have like
One of my favorite feuds with him was him against Dragunov. When he kept insulting him, like, oh, you're bullshit, your kid, you're a bad father.
That was great when they had that. Absolutely agree. No, but let's not move from South culture, because we like, they're still after that. So like they're still like lifting, working out and all of that. And Zaya Brookside shows up with like also Dani Luna, and she says, hey, maybe we should have a match and let's see who the best woman is. So at least we see a storyline here, and two baby faces. We'll see what the outcome is, but at least they always give the girls an opportunity. So that is something that I always appreciate, because you see storylines always brand new. We don't see the same girls all the time. We haven't seen a male now. We haven't seen Nina Samuels. Hey, this is time for this too. Okay, let's see what they can do.
Yeah, and this isn't like a SmackDown or Raw where every woman's segment, here's the champion. We haven't seen Mako for a little while. It's like, okay, last week, we saw, who was Amelia McKenzie?
Amelia McKenzie, yep.
And Stevie Turner. This week, we saw two segments with Dani Luna. We saw she was working out. They said, she's probably the strongest woman, in the whole UK division. They're putting her over. Zaya Brookside's like, yeah, you're strong, but I got speed. Let's see which one's better. So again, it's different women featured every week. We see them get over. We see they have these characters. We know that Zaya Brookside's the, the underdog baby face who never gives up. And why do we know that? Because we see her on TV multiple times, but then when you watch Raw and SmackDown, it's like, who's Toni Storm? Who's this character? Who's Liv Morgan? Like, you don't know who they are because they're never on TV.
Oh, like they are once, and then 3 months later, like they show up just in a tag and random tag. Like, you're right. So let's talk about Dempsey, like William Regal's kid, another promo by him. And the guy looks really intense, and especially he wrestles like the father, like you said, the same style, kind of like rough UK, like British scene. Mm-hmm. Like, this is going to be interesting where he goes, like what's going to be his spot in the NXT UK division. But this is like, I'm really interested to see how is like he's going to be portrayed, and also like, like the style of like his whole character. Because for now, he pretty much says, I'm going to bring it to the professional wrestling world. Now, it's not going to be flips. I remember last week. It's not going to be all of that. It's going to be more, on the mat.
Yeah, and I love how he said he's learning from, he's like, the wrestlers of old. He's like, but to all of you, it will be completely new. Pretty much saying like, you guys don't know how wrestling was. You don't know how it was legit. Yes. I mean, he's already a good promo. He's got the look. I mean, you're Regal's kid, if Regal, shoots you out of him, you're going to be legit. I'm sorry, I'm looking forward to this. I would have him again, just wrestle a lot of guys, just beat everybody. And he's not going to win the belt, but him and Dragunov, I would say you do that. Not right away, but.
But like, maybe made for the Royal Rumble time, like January 2022, you have that ability to bring, build from there. And that would be great. Just, just the clash of styles. And I said, Regal, like he has a big name to like, the big shoes that he has to fill. But we'll see what happens. Let's talk about now Dani Luna, Isla Dawn. Yep. Isla Dawn, the witch, going against Genie. So this was like what? As a consequence of what happened last week, because Isla Dawn was like a Genie's like dressing room, and she like did the star and all of that. So like you saw a potential rivalry here. Did you like this? I was like, yeah, whatever. We need a girls match, and I don't know where the story keeps going. But it always, like Isla Dawn is always interesting because she carries the character really nice.
Yeah, and I mean, the one thing here is like Ginny is, she's one of the top women that's not the champion. I think she could be one, I could easily see her going to NXT, maybe in like 6 months to a year or something, and or NXT 2.0. See, look, now we can call the one NXT UK and then NXT 2.0.
Yeah, exactly.
So now we don't have to call it NXT USA.
So there is a positive on all of this.
Yeah, so, she might be going there. But I mean, I like this match. I thought Isla Dawn looked good in the beginning. But, obviously Ginny uses, what she has to her advantage, her manservant, whatever you want to call him.
Yeah,
her business partner, Joseph Joseph Connors comes, he's like on the apron. He's like, oh, you're bullshit. You know, he's like, you're a creep. You know, you're a weirdo, whatever. Just distracting her. Ginny gets the pin. But you see, to me, like, this doesn't really hurt Isla Dawn because she's such like a weird character. She's still like, even when she loses, she laughs. Like, you know, it's like Alexa Bliss, but it's believable.
Yeah.
You know, like, so, I mean, I was fine with this, you know, this women's match, you know, it Ginny, I was fine with her getting the win. Like, you know, it's fine to feature different women. I have no real complaint.
No, exactly. No, and you have to, and especially because you give me like a little bit of story. Mm-hmm. Hey, you know, she is stabbing in the dressing room. She's a little weird. Like you said, maybe she got lost. Maybe she just wants to feel like Ginny. And maybe she just wants to like have like popularity, have a guy to like whatever like business that they have to take care of. But like at least it's good. Exactly.
Yeah.
But now let's go with like, yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, from a segment I had no problem with, you know, we'll go to one that I really didn't like, which stemmed from, you know, the opening match. We see Dallas, you know, they go into Jordan Devlin's, his dressing room. You know, he has coffee in there. They're drinking it. They're like, oh, this is legit. And then Jordan Devlin goes in. He's like, what are you doing? Get out of my dressing room. They kind of, you know, push him around everything. They steal his sunglasses. They close the door and they're all like, yee, yee, yee.
And,
like,
then they pulled him and he fell or something. Yeah.
I mean, this is just bad because Dallas, to me, you know, their music's badass. They come out there, they're all big guys, you know, they're all like, oh, we're serious, we're on top, and it's like, okay, this is good. And then they act like clowns here. So then that's like, okay, well, you know, which one is it? And it's not the Matt Riddle effect. These guys can't be goofy and stupid and then be legit in the ring, because, you know, the only one who can do that and still be believable is Matt Riddle.
And the original bro, but like they're gonna have the match finally next week, folks, so probably this will be the main event. And, you know, Jordan Devlin probably will get the win. Or I don't know. I really don't know, because Joe Coffey's been losing a lot. You know, so probably they will give the win to Joe Coffey. So, but what do you do with it? You know, because Devlin also, like, has an opportunity there.
Yeah, that's the whole thing here. I mean, this is another thing, like, you know, what I said about Sam Gradwell and subculture. But this is, like, main event level, where it's, like, both these guys need to win. Because, like you said, Joe Coffey just lost the tag team match. And then Jordan Devlin. And lost the Rampage. And Jordan Devlin just lost to A-Kid. You know, so it's like, oh, shit. Like, you know, what are we going to do here? And, I mean, you could have did something where, you know, Dallas maybe gets involved. But then, I don't know. But then that makes Devlin a babyface, which I don't think is a good idea.
No, he could be a heel.
So, I mean, I really don't know. And I thought Devlin looked weak here. You know, they just pushed him out of his own dressing room, laughed at him, and he just stood there like, so.
And you know, that's not the same guy that we saw feuding with Santos Escobar, you know, like a few months ago, and then he went to America and also then lost the championship and all of that. So yeah, little things that like they could fix. I don't know why they need to be in the feud. I get it, like they don't have nothing for them, but maybe if you don't have nothing, fine, stay away one more week. You don't need to be in the show all the time. But let's talk about the triple threat match. Match quality, I will tell you though, like I'm not gonna say that like they watch Danielson and Omega and they're like, okay, let's put such a great show. But this to me like was very, very good, and it kept like the guidelines or the concept or like the tactics of a triple threat match. It's like, hey, you know, like you isolate the one guy, go after the other. Like, and you could tell that each one of them had a strategy. And we're talking about Nathan Frazer, A-Kid, and Rampage Brown. Did you like it? Didn't you like it? But I will tell you, for me at least, it was a plus of a match. Maybe the winner, questionable.
Yeah, I mean, we'll get into the winner at the end of it. But I mean, no, overall, this match was fantastic. You had the two smaller guys, you know, there. It was a thing like, let's work together to beat up the big guy. And then, you know, maybe we'll turn on each other. And you saw that, like, it was, you know, Frazier and A-Kid were beating up Rampage Brown. But then, you know, A-Kid, boom, hits Frazier. And then, you know, Brown gets up and takes out A-Kid. And then even commentary said, well, I don't know if that was such a good idea. You know, maybe he should have kept that partnership with Frazier a little bit longer. But you saw Rampage Brown, to me, was the star of this. Because I would say 50% of the match, it was 2-on-1. And he was handling them both.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it was great. Now, you saw, like, but everybody...
Kido, for example, like, the double DDT was legit, but then he did, like, a double back body drop, so, like, that was also really good.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like you said, Frazier hit the double DDT, you know, but then Rampage Brown fires back, and, I mean, he was really the star of this, but I knew he wasn't going to win, because obviously you can say, oh, well, two guys were beating him up, and I knew he was safe from the pinfall. So I was like, okay, I know he...
We knew those two things,
because, you know, I don't think you're going to do Dragunov as... great as the match was with Walter, I don't think he's going to be the giant slayer. I don't think they're going to have him slaughter all the big men, you know, because then Rampage, what do you do with Rampage Brown if he loses right away? So I figure it was going to be one of these smaller guys, since obviously Dragunov's not losing his first title defense. But, you know, I mean, just the way, you know, Rampage Brown, he hit the big doctor bomb. You know, if we're going to skip all the way, you know, kind of to the end to talk about the winner here, because we don't need to go through the whole match, because the one thing we're going to say is if there's two matches this week so far, if you haven't seen them, Danielson and Omega, check it out in this match.
And this one, very good. Even like even they plug in the chance, you know, like this, it's awesome. Like it felt really good. Like I said, the speed of it, like I said, I don't know if they were, I don't think they were watching Omega and Danielson, because this is probably tape. Yeah. But at least, you know, like they gave us something.
I didn't see it. I don't think it said live, but I didn't really take note. Like,
no, I don't think it is. Yeah. I don't think it is. Like, I think they taped the shows, but like, hey, it was really nice to see like the one was like maybe following the other. So, you said like sequences, like everybody had a fair chance to win this, you know, and that's the one thing that they kept us like, you probably were guessing yourself, oh, maybe in right now Rampage, maybe Frazier, maybe A-Kid. So like that was like, I like that for me it should have been Frazier, of course, but like you said, like see big dog, like the doctor bomb right there, but then the A-Kid actually does this, he takes away of Rampage Brown, and then he does like another kick to Nathan Frazier, and you could say because out of all of those finisher moves that like they've been taking, like you're already like worn out, so
He sent Rampage to the outside, and then he grabbed Frazier when he stood up, hit a huge German suplex, and Frazier's so good at selling, he like folded himself in half pretty much, and then when he kind of got to his knees, like you said, the big jumping kick from A-Kid pins him 1-2-3, and I like that. I like how it's like, this guy's so beat up, I'm not going to do my submission, even though that's his signature finisher, he's like, no, I'm just going to boom, hit two high impact moves and pin him.
That's he needed an impactful move, yes.
Yeah, that's a smart thing, because if this was WWE, Charlotte would have been, oh, let me do the figure eight, and then, oh, let me tap out, even though I should be unconscious because I just got hit with a big move. So,
yes.
You know, smart smart pin. You know, you see Rampage Brown, he's sitting there looking like, damn it, he's pissed. A-Kid's fired up. And, you know, I like A-Kid, but the only problem I have with this is, you know, the whole time you're saying, oh, Nathan Frazier trained by Seth Rollins. Oh, he's so good. He's such a star, this and that. You know, I think Frazier should have been the guy to win this, even though it's two baby faces. A-Kid's also a baby. All three of these guys were baby faces. Yeah, no. So it really didn't matter. I don't know in that aspect. But let's go through since NXT restarted since pandemic. What has A-Kid done? Heritage Cup champion, the first one. Then, you know, he went against Walter as Heritage Cup champion, had a chance to be double champ. You know, he lost it to Tyler Bate, but, you know, legit match there. He beat Jordan Devlin, and now he's the number one contender again. It's like, he can have a non-title feud with somebody else and just fuck off for a couple weeks and let's push somebody else. That's the only issue I have. It's like, but the guy's not he's not a legit promo. He doesn't come out and fired up, dragging off, blah, blah, blah. You've seen everything I've done. You know, I can beat you, you know, blah, blah, blah. This, you know, cut a legit promo. Nothing. You know, he just comes in like, oh, I'm the A-Kid. I'm the best wrestler, blah, blah, blah. Like, you know, I'm so good. And it's like,
that's a big problem, but again, like with the language barrier, like they don't teach you to really be fired up. They don't teach you to express emotion. But like you said, it should have been Frazier. Simple booking. The freshest out of all the three of them. You know, like you said, Brown and Kid, they have already matches. Even they said that on commentary. Why the first feud for a champion, especially Dragon, should have been Frazier? Because you know that like Dragon is going to win, but Frazier is going to give him a good match. Both are going to look good. And then that way, the three guys had an opportunity. So, like, and then maybe we can be later on A-Kid. And then completely later on, maybe it can be Brown. And then maybe the title will change hands. You don't know. Because I don't think Ilya is going to have the same run as lengthy as the Walter.
I could see they want Ilya on either 2.0 Raw or SmackDown. I think he's going to be one of those guys. Okay, you had it for 6 months. Okay, legit. Thank you.
Legit, exactly. So, like, but, you know, for me, the wrong winner here.
Even, probably not even six, maybe
the only
4 months.
Thing is, like, because they probably have history. That's the only thing that they're going to base off, like, the whole narrative of the championship opportunity. And I mean, the same physique. Maybe Ilya's a little bit more, like, you know, ripped and everything. Despite that, it's going to be a good match. A little bit different styles, you know, because the A-Kid is more, like, technical, more submission, but Dragunov is more impactful. But I would much rather to see Frazier, just because he needed that more than the other two. But, I mean, again, bad booking. At least on Robert, we think bad booking.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing, like I said, this match I'm fine with because it didn't matter who won. Dragunov was going to beat him anyway. I think A-Kid will be a good match. But the one thing, you know, again, to say this match, you know, definitely fantastic. Check it out. All like everything they hit, all the kicks, the suplex, everything. It was in there.
It was like you said, the noises, everything is like good. So thank you so very much, family. You know, like a great episode of NXT UK. It made the book in a little bit, you know, hey, questionable for us. You know, hey, it's fine. It's a free world for some people. But like, so please don't forget to just subscribe to the page. Also, like, give the video a like. Also, like, hit the bell for notifications. And don't forget, tomorrow we will be live to do SmackDown and Rampage. Big Rampage. It was already taped. We will not tell you anyway. There's no spoilers. And also SmackDown, the go-home show for Extreme, for normal rules. Because there's only one match has stipulation. So, Paul, where is can they find?
And you can find us, folks, Rope Break on Facebook, the OG Rope Break on Twitter, Original Rope Break on Instagram, Twitch, and TikTok. And, of course, right here on YouTube, the home of the number one podcast in the YouTube wrestling community, the Original Rope Break.
And you and me have one more thing that is left to say, and that is...